L.A. Straight up.
Go out to L.A. The new anthem. California Love Part 2.
One time.
To live in time, L.A.
West Side. West Side. West Side.
To live in time, L.A. Where everybody try to fatten their pocket. So many hustle for the cash.
Well, hello, hello, hello. God bless you, community family, and welcome to Gang Talk with Sister Herron, Skipp Townsend. You can see our co-host is in-house, in his seat, as we always like to see him every Thursday that we come and spend this hour with you to talk about very important business for our community and our village and our people. So God bless you once again, and welcome to Gang Talk.
Thank you.
All right, and as you can see, we have special guests, and we're about to get right into it, but first we have to start by thanking our guests from last week, thanking Skipp for being our co-host. Thank you, Skipp. And yes, thank God that he saved you.
Yes,
thank
indeed.
God, yeah.
I'm truly grateful, Sister, and as I give honor and praise to God, I always give honor and praise to God. I'm grateful to be alive, grateful to be with all of you. I'm grateful to have gone through my experiences and to be able to help others as they go through theirs. But, Sister, I'm having a moment right now. I can't think of who was our guest last week.
You know, that's bad now, Cecil.
I'm sorry.
Dr. Chip and I are struggling trying to remember what happened this morning, so.
It was a former council member, Robert Farrell.
That's oh, right. Yes, Bob
yes,
Farrell.
Bob
that's
Farrell.
Right. That's right.
Yes, indeed. I want to give him a special shout out, and I'm going to tell you why. I've been seeing this man since I was a child. Mm-hmm. I saw what he did in the community, working mm-hmm. for the city, and I didn't have a relationship with him. So in my first conversation with him, he agreed to come on the show.
Oh, okay.
I truly appreciate that.
Wow, that was a big surprise.
You know, a lot of people, I've seen Chip Murray growing up in the community and things, you mm-hmm. know. So all these people I've watched, they embrace me, and I'm grateful.
That's wonderful.
Truly great. That's another gift from God.
Yes,
so once
it is.
Again, I'm giving honor and you know, gratefulness to God.
Yes, and you know what? We're grateful to God because He not only turned you around, but gave you back to us, and now you're giving back to the kids that really need to see someone like you, Skipp. So it's really a big blessing just in your one package called Skipp Townsend. And so you bless so many. Probably don't even realize how many you have touched, but the young people notice, and they respond to you, and they love to post things about you on Facebook and comment.
And there's something,
yeah.
I just saw that recently, a couple of people back to back are saying, if it wasn't for you, you know, and it warms my heart. But, I you know, Tony Massengale, who another one of my mentors, he had told me, he said, Skipp, don't read your press. Don't read your own press, you know? And I never knew what that meant, but I get it now. Like, when people say, well, great job, Skipp, mm-hmm. I have to keep working. I can't stop and say, hey, yeah, great job.
You're right, right.
I have to keep going and give honor and praise to God for allowing me to do his work.
Yes, yes. Well, you know, you're the evidence of what we need. That's who you are. That's what you represent. That's what your image means to us. We need more men to see that they have value in our community, that the young people that we're raising, trying to get them a safe passage through their life, need to hear from men like you that found out, oh, you know, that was a big old trick. I got caught in it, and I don't want you to go down the same dark hole that almost took me away,
mm-hmm.
you know, because it was a dark hole, and there was a moment that your freedom wasn't guaranteed, and
right.
You tell stories about how having been arrested on false charges and
right.
even that detective that told you, well, how'd you like that? And you told him, well, I beat that. And he said, well, how much time did you spend in jail?
6 months.
6 months.
He said, well, you did 6 months for a crime I know you didn't do.
Yeah. Isn't that amazing? And then we have Lamont. Marcus Wood comes on the
17
show.
17 years.
They took him at 17
mm.
and took 17 years of his life for something he didn't do either. So are there flaws in the justice system? Absolutely. And we had, you see, we have our very special guest. He's extra special. And that's Dr. Cecil Chip Murray.
Mm-hmm.
And we're so happy he's joined us again because he's just a wealth of information, and history. And we had prepared for John Mack as well, because they're like a dynamic duo for
Thank
us.
Thank God for John.
Yes. And unfortunately, Mr. Mack didn't get the message. But we did just talk to him. He did say, call him anytime, and he will come. So what I really want to say on air, these two men have been so generous in giving to us that actually February 9th, 2012, is the first time that both of them came to Gang Talk Radio. So today is technically an anniversary of our meeting with them on the air to talk about this.
Yes, indeed.
So what a blessing, and thank you, Dr. Murray, for coming.
Thank you, Lady Lee. Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you. You know, our young people, when you were here before and we had a group of men, they were so happy to meet with you and hear from you. And we'd like to fill the room, make it a crowd, you know, but it's a small studio, and it's just nice for them to have access.
Yes.
That's the best gift that we can give to them, is to have access to living legends and men that have meant so much to us as a people, from the civil rights struggle to your work in Los Angeles through FAME, First AME Church, which we like to remind LA community members that might not know, that is the first African-American church in Los Angeles.
Right.
Okay.
And it's conveniently located, you know where, Sister Herron?
Oh, yes.
On Sugar Hill.
Oh.
Did you know that? When people ask me where I'm from, where are you from? Ask me where I'm from. I'm from Sugar Hill.
Okay.
I'm from Sugar Hill. I know I am. Yes, indeed.
You remember I joked back in those days, Dale and I, my husband of 40 years, lived across the street from FAME.
Okay.
Lived right across the street. And I'm ashamed to say it. We didn't go in.
Didn't go across the street from church.
We were heathens back then.
Them was the heathenites. You guys in the Bible too, heathenites.
Yeah. Well, we were living in the world, and you know, his mother came out and straightened us out, because she raised Dale in the church, and it's like, I'm not letting the world take him.
Right.
No, I'm coming out to Los Angeles.
Well, I have to say, too, that I visited the church many times, and it was because of the funerals that I attended. I don't recall going into the church on a Sunday service unless it was maybe once or twice, because there was something going on.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, so I take that up with God. God knows, though. God knows I was hiding.
He knows.
We wouldn't flush the toilet. Don't flush, because Mama gonna know that it's past church time. So we'd be real quiet and turn the TV on, but keep it down.
Keep it down.
Because if you wake up Mama, we're gonna have to go to church.
I know. You know, a lot of my friends tell that story, and one of them still mad because of how far they had to walk to get to the church and how long they had to stay there, and then the penny they had to put in the missionary offering.
A penny,
and I laughed. Yep. I said, yeah, it ain't a penny anymore.
It's a dollar now.
It's a dollar.
No, it's not a dollar. It was a dollar in my time.
There it is.
Oh, it's way past a dollar.
It's way past. I'm not sure they're even doing the missionary offerings anymore, because the church has rent to pay, so it may just start and stop with the tithe and the love offering for the pastor,
right.
But
mm-hmm.
we don't get into those kind of details, and it's okay.
Amen.
Because we have a great man.
Truly
of God
blessed
right
to have
here.
This man with
yes.
us.
I'm truly blessed to be in the middle of two saints of God. Thank God for you.
Well, you know, if it wasn't for men like you, we wouldn't know how to act. Okay.
He's that balance.
He's the balance.
You're the one that keeps the scales balanced.
That's
for
it.
Us. You know?
Yeah, show us the way, Dr. Murray.
You're in the middle of two heathenites, and we self-admitted heathens, so you have to keep us balanced, sir.
Yes, yes.
Well, Skip, you in the delivery business, you help to deliver young males and females from self-destruction.
Yes.
And that's the business of God. God is in the delivery business. So keep on keeping on.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, he delivered us to be honored to do this show to talk about this very important work that really may not mean anything to anybody else, but it should mean a lot to us as a people. So we're just going to... So grateful to have Dr. Murray here, because we came to talk politics tonight, didn't we?
Oh.
What, Donald Duck? No, Donald Trump. What's her name? Whoopi calls him, calls him Donald Trump.
Yes.
All right. And I call him Twitter Man, so
right.
He's very good at tweeting.
Right.
But not very good at.
So some of the real issues, and, you know, one of our favorites from the community, I don't know where he's from, but Andre Barat.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's definitely a powerful man who,
yes.
who I often would talk to in the jungles,
mm-hmm.
walking in the park. And Jim, I love to talk to people when they're amongst the people.
Yes.
You know, and that's Andre Barat. But
yes.
he was one who challenged the immigration and actually demanded that this man return from Egypt. He was the first before they did in Seattle, Washington.
Okay.
You know, he's been newly appointed under the Obama administration as a federal judge.
Right.
As opposed to, Central Valley Attorney General.
First, he was the Inspector General for LAPD, and then they moved him to the U.S. Attorney's Office,
mm-hmm.
and he was the District U.S. Attorney for Southern California region. And then from there, because we've been getting a lot done with Andre.
Yes.
A lot done under his leadership. So they kind of stole him away from us and made him a federal judge.
Mm-hmm.
But it's good to see that they didn't take away his momentum.
Right.
Yes. The man knows he's here to do a job. And I love the fact that he's consistent to it. So, Skip, you know, I lost Andre's phone number, but I haven't lost my love for him. So we need to find him and invite him back.
Yes.
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 Yes. Yes. Years ago, we sat in the same KTYM studio we did with Dr. Murray,
right.
and we talked to Andre for an hour.
Mm-hmm.
And that was just a 30-minute show.
Mm-hmm.
But we were just having so much lively conversation. It's like, let's do a two-part. And he said, okay. We sat in the chair and recorded second 30 minutes and had two parts to air just from him. So we appreciate that generosity. And also at the same time, when we had to go after law enforcement.
Oh, boy.
Andre helped us a lot, as did John Mack.
He was there.
Yeah.
Both of them.
Yes, they came to our ceasefire meetings
mm-hmm.
when we had real serious problems with the LAPD. And between him and John Mack, they brought everybody that needed to be in that meeting.
Yes, indeed.
Yes.
Oh. I definitely take my hat off to him. And the reason I brought up his name is because he is definitely challenging the president.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a lot of us, like myself, who speak against the president and his views and opinions,
right.
but I don't do action. I don't have an action plan after I speak. So I want to recognize Andre Barat because he had an action plan and he put it in place. And
mm-hmm.
one of the things that he does by doing so is jeopardizing his position. You know, in this political field, when someone stands up against the status quo, what they're doing is jeopardizing their position. You know, and their family and their livelihood. So I just want to take my hat off to him
mm-hmm.
because there's a lot of people who are, I want to say immigrants to the country who have been here for a reason. And just to identify certain groups as Donald Duck did and said that he wants to stop these certain groups, you know.
Well, Donald's family is an immigrant.
Yeah,
his wife is
right.
an immigrant.
Okay. Right.
His original people are immigrants.
Right. America's a nation of
immigrants.
Thank you.
Exactly.
I wanted to get you in to say
only
that.
The indigenous people
right.
were originally here.
Right. Right.
Dr. Murray, get in this conversation.
And it is so critical. The nation, of course, is beginning to rise to the level of care because there is not approval of the president's movement against immigrants from certain Islamic states
mm-hmm.
that they are not welcome. And that's a broad brush that we refuse to use to paint all Islamics as those not worthy of citizenship with us, like others. They are welcome, they are worthy, and each person is to be judged on their own.
Mm-hmm. And historically, the country has received fleeing immigrants that are fleeing from oppressive regimes.
Precisely.
We've done that for countries south of America, and this is a new day. It's a different world order going on right now, and people around the world are in shock. Right. Around the world.
Well, even looking at the history, sister, it's been more of the European nations that America has accepted, no mm-hmm. problem. I'm not sure if you remember the videos not more than 10 years ago with the Haitians, and they were forcing them back on the rafts. And,
on the rafts.
Right. Letting the boat sink, forcing them back on the rafts. Like, mm-hmm. We'll take immigrants, but not you. You know what I mean? It's like, I have a friend, Alex Sanchez. He's El Salvadorian, and he got amnesty, he got mm-hmm. Immunity to be here. But he says that when they used to go back to El Salvador, they would be killed, they would
yes.
be beheaded,
yes.
they'd be tortured and things of that nature.
Yes.
And the United States did not stand up for certain groups of people. Mm. It's really, if we look at these countries that they did accept the immigrants, most of them are of
European
descent.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So, yes. Yes.
I'm not saying they
we have a long way to go to erase 400 years history of racism. We have not as yet admitted it,
mm-mm.
confessed it, certainly made no way to find reparations or repentance for it. And the first five presidents owned slaves.
Yes.
Right.
8 of the 45 presidents owned slaves. Then when you look at the Constitution, when they got ready to go out and count the population, how shall we count these blacks? How shall we count these slaves, Negroes? Count them as 3/5 of a person.
Right.
So the 3/5 compromise said pretty well legally what the country was feeling racially, that blacks are not fully human beings. So we have come a good way, but we have a long way to go.
Right.
It looks really right now like we're stepping backwards. The leadership that was elected or not elected but showed up and is in the White House, we don't know how that happened. We don't know Russia's input in it. It's just a total takeover. Takeover from him through the Senate, through Congress, just a total takeover, one-sided, that's just amazing. And as I said before, troubling on the world stage.
Well, you know what? He's living up to all his expectations. I do want to say that. I thought it was so comical, and I was thinking to myself that he would never be president.
Yes.
Listen to the things that he's saying.
Yes.
And immediately when he came into office, look who he started appointing. Yesterday was very big with Sessions.
Yes.
They did not want Sessions.
Yes.
And I received an email listening to what Coretta Scott King
yes.
said about Sessions.
Said about him.
And she's been deceased now for a minute.
Yes.
So if she could foresee this and remember what he was against when her husband, the great Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., was alive,
right.
then this man has a major influence over people who are looking up to him, and he's been in a powerful position ever since. And he was just appointed yesterday as the U.S.
Yes, the Senate refused to allow the letter from Martin Luther King's wife to be read.
Right.
Right.
It was too much truth she
right.
was telling you.
Right.
Because you are known by your history.
Right.
And if you have a history of being a neoconservative, a racist, one who was applauded by the Ku Klux Klan,
right.
you have to do a lot to erase that. But when you act as if
it didn't exist,
it doesn't exist, then that makes it even worse.
Okay. Right. And since we're surrounded by so many misquotes and alternative facts.
Right. When did that come in?
Oh, my God.
My mother never gave me the option to have an alternative fact.
No.
She would say, boy, you're lying.
You're lying. Mm-hmm.
and,
okay.
And could I have told her, Yvonne, that is an alternative fact?
<That's>...
I would have got hit even worse.
You wouldn't be here.
That's okay. What an alternative fact is, a distortion.
But, wow. You know, the alternative fact that I'm offering is that my understanding is that the KKK has been removed from the terrorist list.
Good heavens, have mercy. Lord, wow. Have mercy.
Yes. I haven't verified that, but it looks like to concentrate on immigrants, they've been given a pass.
Right.
Okay, and if somebody wants to say, sister, you're wrong about that, let me know.
Right.
Let me know, because I'm accepting it as fact.
Right.
You see, because they're natural-born terrorists right here in this country.
Oh, exactly. And they terrorize the South. They terrorize black communities. They're responsible for so many murders. They're responsible for the self-esteem and a lot of black people remaining low, mm-hmm. and never being able to rise. I just recently had a conversation with my son, Carter. Mm-hmm. Whenever I talk to him, he looks down. Mm. And I told him, I said, son, I don't care what I'm talking to you about as a man, the way you will become a man, please look me in my eyes
right. And
be honest with me. Right. And I had to take him back in history that a 13-year-old boy and a 35-year-old man, if that boy was white and that man was black, he had to put his head down.
Yes.
And couldn't look that boy in the eye. And that 13-year-old boy could call that man a boy.
Could call
I said,
boy.
Please don't take us back to that. No. If you're ashamed, if you've done something wrong, I said, you know what? I'll get past it. Look me in my eyes and be honest.
Mm-hmm. That's why America in 2017 is going to be on trial worldwide. Because we call ourselves a democracy. That is a system of the people. We say that we were born seeking to be a democracy. But then here we are, make America white again.
Yes.
Right.
Elected president. And here we have some decisions to make. And we will see if we are going to be fakers or makers.
Okay, because right. I like that. You know, because, you know, the only original people are still under that pressure.
Precisely.
Still under that pressure. And as hard as President Obama tried to halt that pipeline, and those of us living in the real world knew it was just a temporary thing,
right.
because as fast as he got out the way, they were going to take it back and do what they intended to do.
And that might have been by design, sister.
It's exactly by design. They were never going to not build that pipeline. They don't care what the original people said.
They just needed the time to wait.
Yes.
And I believe that's why they waited till the end of his presidency.
Yes.
To start that
yes.
Dakota pipeline.
Yes, yes, yes. And this is a kind of loss of control that democracy is experiencing now. And I've been joking, it looks like a corporate takeover.
Yes.
And that's what it is.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yes.
But yeah. We will see what the flavor is. We could make it the year of the woman, because women are saying enough, mm-hmm. and they are demanding rights, as they should. The LGBT community is demanding rights, as they should. The underserved Hispanic community, Asian community, they are demanding rights. Certainly the black community, longer than any other community in our history, they should be demanding rights. Mm-hmm. So what year will it be? Well, we have social media now so that you can't hide the truth. Mm-hmm. Somehow or another, the truth will get there, even if the truth is a lie. It's going to be spread, and you have the option of knowing whether it's the truth or a lie. But the word is going to get on the line. You can't hide what you do anymore. Mm-hmm. So social media is plus and minus.
Yeah. You know, I'm so glad you said that, because I learned something today. The very first casualty in any war will always be the truth.
Mm-hmm.
Well said.
The first casualty of any war will be the truth. That will be the first thing that will be killed.
Right.
And it's just so important that you just brought that up as well. And I just learned that today. Social media will help to eliminate that. If we can capture it and record it, then it will be hard to have that first casualty.
Well, because it's Black History Month, let's just remind all the freed slaves that that war was not fought to free you. Don't you need to stop getting that confused. That Civil War was not fought to free you.
Right.
It was fought to preserve the Union and break the wealth that the South had from the free labor they got through slavery.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So those were the real reasons they fought that Civil War, to preserve the Union and to break that financial hold the South had on the North through free labor. So,
yes, because even after the Civil War, they had the period of so-called recovery, mm-hmm. but it only lasted 12 years, where blacks were supposed to be allowed to get education, where blacks were supposed not to be worked without being paid, and so forth, and the lynchings were not mm-hmm. so long. We went through some very serious phases, just downright racial discrimination, segregation, mm-hmm. then discrimination, then by culture, civil unrest, mm-hmm. and then finally the movement for civil rights in the 60s and the 70s. We at least began to talk with some sense, but then we have to show that the talk is for real, because the man who heads up the most powerful nation in the world, the richest nation in the world, that man, they looked at him and saw his color. They looked at him, the Republicans particularly, the conservatives, the Tea Party, and saw his color,
yes.
come in determined to turn down the health program, and that the new president did in his first week to start putting it aside.
Right.
When America's the only nation in the industrialized world without a universal health care program,
yes.
then you go on and on at all the pluses that have been accomplished under the Barack presidency. And one day he will be remembered as one of our greatest presidents.
Yes.
But for a year or two, we are on trial.
Yeah. Well, you know what? You talked about slavery, and it was time for break. And I know Stevie Wonder's not going to set us free, but he's going to sing to us about being free.
All
and we'll
right.
come back
like the river.
All right.
Be free. God bless you, community, family, and welcome back to Gang Talk. That was a short break, but you know, we love the music that we share with you because it has a message, and we know you love our entertainers, and we love them too, and the best thing that they give us is their truth, the way they see things, and it might not be everybody's truth, but it sure is ours, and that's what makes them so important to us. We have to be able to tell our truth the way we see it, the way we're living it, the way we have to manage it. So God bless you once again, and welcome back.
And as you speak about the truth, I think of John 8, verse 32. You shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free.
Mm-hmm.
And when I look at a suppressed generation, a depressed generation, when I look at those who have built the infrastructure of this nation, but yet who are still being treated with a slave mentality, mm-hmm. the nation needs to know the truth. But even if the nation doesn't learn the truth, then blacks in the nation need to know the truth about themselves.
Mm-hmm.
That's why your job dealing with gangs is so important. That gang banger needs to know that he is more than a street walker,
yeah.
dragging his pants with his shorts showing,
yeah.
dropping out of school, calling our women bitches and whores, fighting the brothers and so forth and that. You need to know the truth about your excellence. Yes. Coming to America as early as 500 BC, when Columbus didn't get here till 1492 AD. And when he got here, he didn't know where he was. But the black culture is still on the mountain walls down in the Caribbean and other parts of the nation bearing their marks. You shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Amen. And you know what? And we need to stick with the truth. We were just talking about the civil rights struggle, the Civil War, all of that stuff supposed to be done to favor us. And you look at where we are now, it looks like nothing's changed. We still live in segregated communities. My kids still go to segregated schools. You know, and we talked last week about the busing when it was an opportunity transfer, right, and how, yeah, we could go out to their schools, but they weren't coming in
they
here to our schools. They were not going to do that. So we never did get the elevation in the inner city schools that that was supposed to bring about. So that was one of the main reasons I sent, and I fought to send him, I really did, to later be disappointed that I did, but I sent him out to a valley school because I wanted him to get an equal education. I wanted him to get the same exposure that their children were getting to education.
Okay, so look, I got an issue, and I'm going to bring it up to you two.
Go
you guys
ahead.
Are my elders. I believe, and this is just me, that my mother did the same thing. She wanted me and my brother to get an education. She sent us to Catholic school.
Yeah.
And then when the opportunity transfer came, she sent us to the Valley.
Yes.
And I think that I would have been much better had she put me in a Marcus Garvey type school.
Right.
Had she put me in a school that would have taught me that my blackness was everything yes. that Cecil Murray just said,
yes.
that I'm not some thug yes. and pull my pants up. I needed that. I did not need to learn to be white or to speak the King's English or to learn the history of Christopher Columbus discovered this great land. I did not need that. I needed someone to empower me
yes,
in my blackness.
I agree. And see the problem, and then we were pushing education. That was right. the thing. I wasn't pushing sports. I was pushing education. And 'cause I wanted our children, my children, to have that education. I wanted them to be on the same playing field,
right.
okay? But we sent him all that way. He spent 6 years on that bus riding out there, only to go to his high school to have one of his teachers call him a stupid nigger.
Oh, boy. And you're going to...
And that was El Camino High School.
Right.
I'm just going to go ahead and call him out because of that, my son will never go to that campus. He will never go to where they call that...
Alumni stuff.
Yeah, he ain't never going back there. Right. But I had to drive all the way out to that campus to meet a teacher that called my child a stupid nigger. And when I went out there, not only did the principal ignore me, sent me right to the teacher, and that guy told me, well, if the shoe fits.
Hit him in the head with it.
Man, I wanted to hit him so bad. I'd be in jail right now.
Right.
I'd be in jail right now if I responded the way I wanted to.
Right.
But that showed me right there, your kid don't belong out here with this kind of
but
nasty
you know what?
Stuff.
I like that.
From the
like,
top to the bottom.
Why? I like that because they're telling me they don't want me. So I need to listen. So had I been your son, I'd have said, Mama, let's go. They don't want us here.
But he was already, this was in the 11th grade. So he's almost out the door. He's almost out the door. Look, that's why we made sure that our other two kids went to schools in the city.
Right.
That reason right there just shut that door for me. It's
okay.
Like I'm not sending my children out here to be mistreated and disrespected that way.
Okay, but listen, sister, so imagine Chip Murray. Has Chip Murray Academy. Imagine a John Mack has John Mack High School. Imagine we have someone who has elementary schools and middle schools in the community that empower us, that tell us who we are as people, that could take us. When Chip Murray and John Mack was here last time, do you remember how my face lit up? Not knowing that one of them went to Tuskegee.
Right.
To college. And, you know, coming from the South and the things that they were doing and that's that whole walk, I need to hear that
yes.
to make me a better person.
Yes, yes.
So had I heard that when I was 7, 8, 9, I would have gravitated to that. Mm-hmm. That I was told I didn't want to be black. I wanted to be Bruce Lee.
Yes, you tell us
that. I want to be Bruce Lee. I want to be a little Chinese boy. They say you African booty scratcher, you this and, you know, and all the negative stuff. I disassociated with being black. Mm-hmm. I needed someone to embrace it right. And empower me in
and
being
that
black.
Is where the truth comes in. And the truth comes in not just in the nuclear family, but in the extended family. In the nuclear family, the divorce rate is 50% in America and rising. Yeah. So that father is conspicuously missing in some homes. Yeah. And in the underserved communities, you need that male presence there.
Yes, you do.
But you need that healthy male presence
right.
there.
Healthy male,
you don't need that unhealthy presence that beats the wife or that unhealthy presence that takes drugs in front of the kids, or that unhealthy presence that doesn't go and see how the kids are doing with the schooling and all that. The truth is to be known by that kid growing up, because even if you send that kid to Harvard, one of the greatest schools and so forth and so on like that, if he doesn't know the truth about himself, then he will try to pretend to be white when instead of saying that he is who he is and there's an obligation he owes to truth. Truth helped him to graduate from one of the top universities in the country. Now he must take that truth and spread it among those who, like he, would not have been there if it were not for knowing the truth.
Mm-hmm. You know, you mentioned something really, really critically important here. Barack Obama was raised in their community, okay? He went to Harvard. He didn't go to my schools. He didn't go to Manuel. He didn't go to John Muir. He went to Harvard, okay? So he got exposed to that arena. He has white friends that adore him. And what it helped him do was assimilate in their world to know how, what to expect. That's really what they taught him, what to expect from them. Okay? And the Republicans are the perfect example of what he had to fight to get to who he was at Harvard. Now, his daughter decides she wants to go to Harvard to follow in her father's footsteps. Look at all the backlash she got. Right. Look at all the backlash that little young girl got just for wanting to go to her father's alma mater. You see, so it tells me on some levels, we just talked about the dumpster giving the Klan carte blanche, well, not carte blanche, but giving them a pass or removing them from the terror watch.
No, he gave them some brand new sheets so they can just cover up. That's what he gave them. He gave them some so they can cover up. He didn't uncover them. He let them cover themselves again and go back into the night, you know. But one of the best schools, the HBCUs, is Howard University. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of people I know who are of Caucasian descent who go to Howard for about 3 years, and then they go transfer to Stanford or USC to graduate.
Right.
They get their knowledge and education
from Howard,
from these black schools, these historical black universities, and then they go so the degree on the wall says USC or Stanford or something prestigious.
Right. You know, every time my class has a class reunion, and we finished high school in 1947 in West Palm Beach, Florida. Mm-hmm. Florida, very segregated place. Mm-hmm. All whites, all blacks go to some such school. But there was no teacher, as I began with third grade in my memory, that did not say during that first week of class, "Now, you going to learn in my class." Mm. They can call you dumb if they want to, but you not dumb, right. And you going to prove it to me. You going to do your work. You going to do your reading. You going to work in my class. Mm-hmm. And that went right on through to high school.
Right.
Then you go into college. What do you mean you thinking about it, so and so and so. You going on to college. Mm-hmm. 93% of our class graduated and went to college. Most of us had found a way to get a scholarship and so forth mm-hmm. and so on. Then when we gather and we go over those, very seldom do we talk about it without some tears beginning to fall. Yes. Yes. Because we have come over a way that tears have been brought, have given to us, but we had the strength from not just the nuclear family, daddy and mom, real great, but today the divorce rate is pretty high. Yes. So we need the extended family yes. now. Yes. We need the neighbors that are no yes. kin to yes. you. We need right. the teachers that are not necessarily there to make sure you graduate, but are there working afterwards. Mm-hmm. We need churches that have after school programs yes. where yes. volunteer teachers right. from the yes. church will come and help out those kids right. who are making falling grades yes. and so forth and so on.
There are a lot of things our churches could be doing. And the sad thing in our history, the churches were our political hub, you know, our community hub. We got things done through the church. We had our community meetings at the church. We helped children, even discipline, counseling for marriages and all that kind of things. Our churches were in service to the community.
But Lady Herron, do you know where the churches are now? It may blow you out of the water to see the recent statistics, and they are pretty well known. In American churches generally, Catholic, Protestant, Holiness, Church of God, so forth, so on. In American churches, there's a 60% dropout rate.
Yes, yes.
And blacks and browns are overrepresented in dropping out of mm-hmm. churches. Mm-hmm. In underserved communities of blacks, underserved communities of brown, there's a 50% dropout rate. Those who don't finish high school, most of them dropping out in eighth grade. When a high school graduate in a lifetime earns three times as much money as a high school dropout, and a college graduate in a lifetime earns three times as much money as a high school graduate,
yes.
we have to have that extended family that will help us to know the truth about our own merits. But, of course, they have to know the truth about their own.
Yes, yes. And that's the problem. We have a generational fracture in us that the last generation is not communicating with this generation, and this generation doesn't really want to talk to the last generation because they're kind of mad at us, you see. And so there's that division, and we're trying to reach them to let them know it's okay for you to be angry with us. Yes, we failed you in a lot of ways, but we're still in that same village. Your struggle has not changed. Mine has not changed. It's not going to change for us until we come together and make decisions for ourselves, because we've been trying to assimilate, trying to get along with people didn't want us in there, trying to agree with their decisions at the expense of our own.
Okay, so now here, let me bring you to full circle to where we are, and we're talking about politics. So Donald Trump has given us our,
you know what? I like Donald Duck. I like Donald
Duck. So don't disrespect Donald Duck like that.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so listen, though. But this man has given us our black leaders. He has brought I don't know who this man is, this pastor out of Detroit. Y'all know who it is?
Oh.
The guy who said the gang leaders called him
from
Chicago.
Never heard about him until I saw that story.
Right, okay. So this man, he is now our black leader, according to Donald.
No.
So is Steve Harvey and Ray Lewis,
no.
and one of my mentors as well, Jim Brown.
No.
But here's the thing for me. How can he determine who our leaders are? And these are the people who are supposed to speak for us. And you talk about why are the blacks and the browns dropping out? Because Jim Brown is accessible, but did he meet with the community first?
What?
Did Steve Harvey has worked, I know, with Bo Taylor, and you know, both of these are mentors of mine, right?
Yes.
But have they talked to any of us? Have they called you, poetess? Have they called any of the people who are doing the work in the community? Have they called any of you? How can these people go and do this photo shoot?
I got an answer for you.
Good.
One
good.
Word.
Let's hear it.
Her name is Omarosa.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. That's the only way Donald Trump chump was able to get in right. touch with Steve Harvey.
Right.
Okay, and Jim Brown.
Right.
Okay. Kanye, I can't explain. I'm going to leave
well,
Kanye
Well, no, he
out
came right out the hospital.
I'm
going to
leave him alone.
So we're going
to
leave Kanye
I'm
going
to leave Kanye alone. But the point is, he has set this woman up to be some kind of bridge
liaison.
Builder. Yes, liaison and bridge builder in our community. When Omarosa was a paid, hired, what I'm trying to find something politically nice to say.
No, say
but
it.
But on The Apprentice, she was the snake.
Right.
She
right.
was the snake. She was malicious. She was vicious. She was unreliable. She was not a team player.
Right.
But he liked that in her. He liked that pit bull kind of way that she
or
conducted herself. Yes, the way she conducted herself on that show. So he liked that about her. So that's the best you have to offer me is her. Really?
Right.
And the best she brings is Steve Harvey. Really?
Right.
Really? And Jim Brown surprised me. He surprised me. See, because what I'm looking for that we're not seeing is that coalition of black folks.
Right.
How you set Steve Harvey up as my leader? He's an entertainer.
You know, and
that's
and
like
think
saying
about
Beyonce.
This.
Why didn't you appoint
Beyonce
well,
look
as
at this.
Secretary
but,
of State?
But here's the thing. So these are the people of influence. As you said, Beyonce, Jay-Z as well. These are people of influence. But what other culture, what other community uses entertainers
well,
as their leaders?
You. Thank you.
But
thank
in our culture, in our community, the young, the millennials, of course, would rather have Beyonce, but not where I'm talking about. Can we have this
rather
Chip Murray
Beyonce
School?
Than,
can we have a John Mack University? Can we?
Yeah,
have
we need
a,
that.
We, this is what I believe we need.
We need
is
that.
People who are on the ground who understand what the community needs.
Well, this is what I want to get Dr. Murray in this. This is our where we need to go next with this, and we're running out of time. So you know,
how do you
Skip,
know? You know we're
I'm looking
to.
At my.
Oh, all right.
Okay. But our clock, look, I'm just going to show you. It's on the
yes.
same time. Can you see it?
It's still
at 6 o'clock.
O'clock. Right.
Okay. So anyway, but we have to keep up. But this is the what I wanted to get into. The black rebuilding, what we need to be doing for ourselves. And Skip brought an excellent recommendation that it really needs to start with our schools.
And that with, that is with our truth. And there's a second component beside knowing the truth that'll be your instrument for setting you free. But the second one is necessity. If you are going to survive in the 21st century, the 22nd century, the 23rd century, then necessity says that you must equip yourselves for that survival. You cannot go around crying out, poor me, segregation, poor me, discrimination, poor me, racism and racial bias. Necessity says you must rise to the occasion. In school, you must finish school and not let the streets finish you, but the school, the education finish you. On the jobs, you must see that in the level of vice president up to president, 97% of those positions are filled by white males.
Yes.
And of the 3% remaining, 50% of those are filled by white females
yes.
put there by affirmative action. When you see necessity, then necessity is the push that will give you. Necessity sets you free from chains. Necessity sets you free from the ropes hanging from trees to a large extent. Necessity sets you free from them saying you too dumb to read because you are not only reading, you are writing. Necessity will be there because white America is not necessarily going to do for black America what black America better do for itself.
Yes.
You're going to have the truth and you're going to have the push by those who hate the truth, and that will set you free.
Okay. See, because right now we're looking at the original people in South Dakota. This country belonged to them. Okay? It was stolen from them by immigrants.
Right.
immigrants. So this country,
they didn't have the right laws in place. They should have had the laws in place that we're not taking immigrants from certain countries.
That's a big joke. Okay, we wish the original people wish all you Europeans to go back mm-hmm. home. Okay, and you know, we just laugh about that because they talk about make America great. Make it great again? You stole this land from the original people. You killed them. You killed their women. You killed their children. You stole their homes.
They are less, the population is less than black people, and we are between 11 and 12% in this United
States. Then they stole us from our homeland, brought us over here, chained us to each other, whipped us, and made us be the free labor for
them. Make America great again.
Okay, and so when you say make America great again, what are you talking about? Because black folks are not going back in chains. We're going to free our young people from this prison industrial complex, make them understand that's a one-way ticket back to the plantation. That's right. What that is. Prison is back to the plantation. You're in a jumpsuit, orange one.
And that's one category. America leads the world in prison construction and
yes.
prison confinement. 2.2 million
yes.
are in prison at this tick of the watch.
Yes.
50% of them black.
Yes.
35% Hispanic.
Yes.
And of those 1 million who are there black, 90% of them are there for nonviolent crime,
yes.
substance
yes.
abuse.
Substance abuse.
Substance
yes.
abuse.
Yes.
So now Proposition 47, as you remember, has pulled out mm-hmm. that as a violent crime
right.
and made it a misdemeanor. So those
right.
prisoners are going to have to be released and all. And but if we don't have programs, they're going to be recycled because one out of three prisoners is back in prison within 3 years of
right.
being released.
Well, that's a plan.
Yeah, which is the plan.
Yeah, that's the plan.
And unless we understand the plan to counter that plan, then necessity will make it happen.
Well, the joke is follow the money. It
right.
takes $8,000 a year to educate one child, where the minimum in that cell for that same year, the minimum is $35,000. To $50,000
yeah.
a year.
Yeah, I was going to say it's around 40-something thousand.
Yes,
right.
at least 40-something thousand. Yeah,
right.
there
mm-hmm.
it is. You see, so it's more profitable to lock you up than to teach you anything.
Precisely.
Okay, and now we're selling stock on Wall Street for
right.
prisons, okay? So where do I invest my money?
Then you look
my
at
nickel.
The homeless situation.
Yes.
3 million. And the richest, most powerful nation in the history mm-hmm. of 3 million homeless.
Mm-hmm.
Now, President Barack at least started fighting to get homeless veterans
yes.
into
mm-hmm.
housing and
yes.
the programs for housing. And now that's working so well, they're beginning to look at civilian homelessness, but then look at hunger. In the richest, most powerful nation in the history of the world, 30 million Americans go to bed mm-hmm. hungry
mm-hmm.
every night.
Yeah.
19 million children don't know where the next meal is coming from. And the inordinately, it's mostly blacks and browns, the underserved, who are in those categories.
Yeah.
So we have some real challenges that we can and must meet in this year, in this time, mm-hmm. and in spite of, because mm-hmm. we ain't going to meet them because of.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, the leadership of our nation, we have a person we have to deal with in spite of,
right.
and we can do it. Because we must do it.
We must. You're absolutely right about that. So that's two things. We need to control our own schools, and we need to encourage our kids to go back into teaching.
Right.
Learn how to be a teacher
right.
so you can teach our children the truth instead of sending to a stranger that doesn't care whether they know it or not.
Right.
You see? So that's the kind of control we need to encourage our kids to look at.
So looking at the school system, and what I was taught today, the first casualty of any war is the truth.
Is the truth.
So why would I teach your children the truth in my school?
Mm-hmm.
Why would I do that? Let me teach them to lie. Well, sister, we're going to have to listen to Earth, Wind, and Fire.
We got a time already.
Yes, we are.
That was a fast hour. We love you so much, Dr. Murray.
But keep your head to the sky, though.
Yes, and we're going to bring him back again.
Lady
God bless
Herron,
you, family.
You are a pathfinder. And Skip, I'm glad I'm named Chip.
Thank you, God, for being a way maker.
Yes, sir.